This conference will now be recorded.
Hey Jim, can you hear me?
I hear you now.
I hear you now.
Hey, are you okay in there?
I can hear you now.
I got them going through my laptop now, but I don't think they were.
You?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't know if it's the system or what.
I don't know if you got connected to it. I'll go check it out. Let me see if I know.
You're good. Hello, hello. Hello, hello, hello.
Is your mic on?
My mic is on.
There you go. Go ahead, sir.
Sweet. All right. Just to begin with this, I wanted to talk to you about a guy, and this guy is named James Smith. James Smith graduated from high school in 1967, and from then on he went to Sam Houston State University. He got his degree and then had a long, wildly successful career. He married his wife Sherry, and they've been married for over 30 years. They have two grown children who are also married. Their names are Jeremy and Tiffany. He has a John Deere tractor, and he's proud of that for a man his age. that he still mows his own lawn. He has a great sense of humor. A thing that is so special in his life is his 7 grandchildren. He loves those grandchildren. And if they're playing a sport, him and his wife Sherry are there. And it was really cool. He just took his oldest granddaughter to New York and they had tea. And it's not like this like Keurig tea. This is like this high fancy tea experience. He had this with his granddaughter. He is really all in with his grandchildren. They also have a dog named Oliver. He is one of those fancy golden doodle dogs. And he weighs 36 pounds. They recently neutered him because he was getting a little crazy. So they thought, man, if we neuter Oliver, maybe he'll calm down a little bit. So just a real quick confession. I have no idea who James Smith is. If you just type in what is the most common name in the United States, you're going to get James Smith. So you can go on Facebook, you can type in James Smith, and then I found a James Smith that I had no mutual friends with, and that is the guy that I just introduced to you. So psychologists are going to say that I do not know James. I know information about James. And so these psychologists are going to say that there's a difference between knowing someone and knowing things about that person. And so this doesn't matter if you're a Christian or not. Psychology says there's a difference between knowing about and knowing. And so psychologists would say that I know a lot about James Smith, but I don't know him. I could be an acquaintance. I'd be able to somewhat smoothly enter into a conversation with him. And I could recognize him from his photos. I could go in. Like literally, I just saw him, like getting coffee or whatever. I could walk up to him, sit down and say, James, like, how are you? Is Sherry around? How's Oliver doing? Has he calmed down a little bit? Are you enjoying your retirement? How are your grandchildren? How's that teen experience with your eldest granddaughter in New York? Was that a good experience? I could just literally walk in.
He'd probably be like really freaked out, but I could recognize him. I can know information about him enough to have an actual conversation.
But still, psychologists can say that I do not know him. I just know information about him.
Oh, my camera. Did I leave my mic on? No. Sweet. Awesome. So to know someone is to have more than just these facts about a person. It's to know particularly intimate or private details about that person, more of these external details about James' life to actually know him. I would need to sit across from him to make a conversation to begin to unpack some of these things that have been unseen. If I got to sit across from James, he'd begin to tell me with tears in his eyes this hopes and dreams for his grandchildren, his concerns for his children, the fears that he currently walks in, and the joys that he's also currently walking in, something that Facebook could never tell me, and this conversation on the type of information that must be earned by lovingly being in someone's life for a period of time. Then I could say, yeah, I know James. I don't know him because I know his dog's name. I don't know him because I know that he likes to travel or how he likes his steak or what he thinks about Sherry. Rather, I've seen aspects of his life that have been hidden from the general population. And so where I want to go with this is we're going to be in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, in verse 5. There's just a really incredible statement that we get to figure out about God. If you want to go ahead and put that verse up. It just says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nation. And so really, I'm just going to really go at the very beginning of this verse where it says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And so, I've heard this verse many times before, and I'm sure a lot of you guys have heard this. But it is just really out, like, it is crazy that God not only knows us, but God knew us before we were even created. And so I just really want to go with this on, like, how do we know that God knows us? And then we're going to go at the end of this on how do we know God? And just kind of going through these, both of these things. And so here in Jeremiah, Jeremiah is a prophet, and God is sharing with him that he knows him. This prophet, Jeremiah, any prophet really, is one who would know information about the future that God has revealed to him, and he would share to the people. So he'd be a messenger from God to the people about a specific message or specific events to talk to people. And so in the midst of this call that God has given to Jeremiah, Jeremiah discovers that God knows not only his name or information about him, but God knows him. And I think it's maybe difficult today, at least for me, because I think we live in just such an impersonal world today. You can literally do everything, and maybe like the coronavirus has even escalated this even more. We can literally do just about everything online. We can shop, we can bank, we can go to school, we can do our work, we can essentially do all of these things from the convenience of our computers without talking to literally anyone. For me, this is a little bit difficult to imagine that, okay, if like I'm in this impersonalness, that God truly knows who I am on an intimate level. And so here's the thing, that God knows us better than any of our spouses or any of our parents or any of our friends, and God knows everything about us. So I just think this is just like a truly crazy statement. That God knows us before he even created us. And so before it was even a thought in our parents' minds to have us, even before it was a thought before our grandparents decided to have our parents, God already knew us. Like, he didn't know, like, okay, like, Brad's going to be 5'8", Brad is going to be pretty funny. No, he knew my soul, he knew my heart, and in that, he gave me a specific task or a specific task to do on this earth. I was created for a purpose, that God knew me, and then he said, like, I don't have a Brad, I need a Brad. Like, oh gosh, like, we got to make a Brad. To me, this is like, God does not have to know us. God did not have to choose to know us in an intimate way. God could have said, all right, like, I'm sitting on the throne. At the end of the day, I'm just going to get some facts about you, and I'm going to base my decisions based on these facts that I got, and that would be it. And I truly do think that would be just and fair for that to be the case. But that is not the case. And I do have another scripture in 2 Corinthians, and this is talking about what I was just talking about at the judgment seat. This is what it says. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. So at the judgment seat of God, we go up there, and God knows us. And so it's not going to be someone who is far removed from the situation, and he opens a book and says, Brad Schein, like, got to go. Okay, here's what Brad does. God will know me. He'll go, oh, hey, Brad, like, I was just, hopefully, he's like, I was just talking to you. But hopefully that's the case. And so we have a God who is not just distant. He is very in the midst of all of this, knowing who we are. There is an awesome song that it was just released not too long ago by Elevation Worship, and it's titled The Blessing. And this is what it says about God. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping, in your rejoicing, he is for you. He is for you. And really, that is like the testament of God. Him knowing you is that he is always with you. You can't know someone if you do not spend time with them. And so just as God spends time with us, getting to know us, he's also asking us to know him. And that is also an incredible thing, that we have the opportunity to know God, not just facts about him in a book, but we actually get to know the real living God. And really, that is a privilege, because back in the Old Testament, we know that you could not have this personal relationship with God unless you were a priest. And so the priest would go into the temple. They would get to go into the holies of holies, the most inner part of the temple. And there they'd go under the veil, and like they would get to talk to God like once or twice a year, bringing sacrifices and all that fun stuff. And then the priest would go to God on behalf of the people, and then on behalf of God back to the people. We also see that with Moses. He goes up the mountain to talk to God. Not everyone, only Moses. Moses went back down to the people and talked and said, here's what God said. And then he went back up and told God what the people said. So we have this very impersonal relationship. And then when Jesus died, one of my favorite parts of scripture is, you know, the veil was torn. So there's no longer that barrier of this impersonal relationship that we have with God. God gave us the opportunity, the privilege of the veil was torn, and now we do not have to go through a priest. We do not have to go through a Moses. We can directly go to God. And I just think that's incredible, because like God doesn't have to. Like, we could literally have to just, it'd be easier to go through one person, have a mediator, but God chose to say, I want to know my creation, and I want them to know me. And I just think that's really incredible. I also have a verse here in, at the end of the, almost to the end of Jeremiah here, a verse that we all know that is super cliche, Jeremiah 29. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. And so my last message was about the Good Samaritan, one of the greatest commandments, Jesus, to love God with all your heart, mind, strength, and soul, to love God with everything you got, and then to love your neighbor as you love yourself. And so here in Jeremiah 29, we get part of that, of how do we know God? It says, how do we know God? Well, first of all, it says that God knows us, that he says that he knows the specific plans that he has for each of us, not just a prophet. You don't have to be a prophet. You don't have to be Moses for God to say, I know you. You can be just anyone he knows. That he has specific plans for us, and those plans are not for bad, they're not for evil, they are for good things. And then that future, he says that if you call upon me and you come and pray to me, he will hear us, he will listen. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. So when you go to God and you say, Lord, here I am, here are my requests, here's what the conversation I want, God says that he will earnestly and willingly listen to you. And so that is also a thing that, like, God does not have to do. God literally could just sit up there and go, here's what's happening. We'll just see kind of how it plays out. I'm God, and then I'll come back in like 1,000 years and kind of see what's happening. But God chooses not to do that. He chooses to be in the midst of not just what's going on, but he chooses to be in the midst of what's going on in each of our lives. And so I'm just like reminded about, you know, the story of Esther, and she says, I was created for such a time as this. And what the Lord is saying is like, that's just not true about Esther or Jeremiah. That is true about us, that it was an accident that you were living through coronavirus 2019, 2020, right now. God specifically knew you and said, like, this is the time that they have to be here for this, or it won't work. And so to me, that is like encouraging. Not that everything is set up in my life where I'm a robot just doing commands that have been given to me. But God saw the gifts of you guys. He saw the gifts in me and said, like that's the time for them. Like that's where they're going to thrive. That is where they are. I mean, there might be some hard things for them, but ultimately, their gifts are going to be used in this time period, not the 1600s, not when Moses, but in 2020 is the time for Brad's, for the time for Henry, for the time for Javier. That is the time for them. And so to me, that is like crazy that not only the Lord cares to know us, but the Lord has cared enough to know us where he knows where we'll exceed the best for not only our glory, for the benefit of ourselves, which God promises, but for the glory of himself. And so to me, it just blows my mind that God has chosen to know us.
And so, at the end of that verse, going a little bit further, before you were born, God appointed you. God appointed Jeremiah to be a prophet.
So God has given us a similar thing, maybe I'm not going to be a prophet to the nations, probably not.
But God has also assigned us these tasks or some tasks to do. And I don't know, I think it's just interesting to see that as the older that we get, maybe we've worked maybe at a job for 20, 25 years. We're like, all right, time for retirement or to end this thing out. And then we're just kind of coast through it. I think my main job here is done.
Like, I think we're finished here. And that is not the case because you are still alive. God is still using you. God is still going to use you because your purpose that God has given you is not finished. And to me, that is also super encouraging that I am still alive right now because my job is not done. And so it is really cool because I feel like I have gotten to do a lot of really cool things for the Lord. But something is still going to happen. Something is still going to come where I can be used by the Lord for the glory of himself. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. And so this word appoint just means to assign officially, to equip or furnish. And so the Lord has not only assigned you to these missions, he has also equipped you or going to equip you to do these in the way. And so it's really cool that the Lord doesn't say like, hey, like, there you go, like, have fun. He also will give us things, either experiences or teachings to help us complete those tasks that he has given us. And so I can't really think of a better way to know God than the reminder of what communion is. When Jesus was in the upper room, he was about to die, like literally the next day. Just before, he literally got on his knees and said, you will not be my disciples if you do not let me serve you. He washes the feet of the disciples so intimately, stooped down to the lowest of lows. But in this meal, he goes, this is my body broken for you. This is my blood poured out for you and for your sins. And so it's not a catch-all here of, this is my body broken for them. This is my body broken for everyone. Jesus specifically says, this is my body broken for you. And this this very personal way of going, Brad, I know you. I know your sins. I know what you're going to do. And I know ways that you're not going to show me glory. But I know all that. But still, this bread is broken for you. I mean, we just see, like, even in Jesus's own lineage, Jezebel, a prostitute, like, Jesus comes from that family, and that's included in the story for a reason, that Jesus is fully man, fully God, but he has this, his background. Jezebel has this thing, but she is not out of the limit of God. God knows her. God knows us, and he chooses to still take part with us. I think when I, like, know the information about myself, things that I've done, things that I've thought, things that I've said, I start to go, like, ooh, like, I don't know, if I was God, I am not so sure about myself. like, yikes. Like, even if we did, like, a tally system of, like, good and bad things, it's not really close. But God chooses to look at that, to actually don't turn a blind eye, to actually look at those things and go, by the blood of Jesus, still worthy. And so that is, like, the most beautiful news that I could share, a thing that I was just this past week really got a grasp on of, like, man, like, it'd be one thing for God to know me while I'm alive, like, okay, Brad's born, like, okay, who's this guy? Okay, I'm starting to get it. Okay, that's Brad. But God has chosen to know me before I was even made, giving me purpose in life, for mission, for his glory, and put me in a specific time for my benefit, ultimately for his benefit and the benefit of others, so we can all experience God even more. And so, like, if I could leave a question, I guess it'd be, are you willing to fulfill that calling, even if you do not know what that calling is? Because I feel like most of us do not know, perhaps we haven't been given a specific calling by God of, like, okay, in the year 2036, on January 3rd, this is what's going to happen. It's most likely going to be way more vague than that of, on your calling, like, are you going to be the most faithful spouse that you can be? Are you going to be the best father? You're going to mess up, but are you going to keep trying and trying to raise that child up for the glory of myself? And so I think God has appointed these tasks, and maybe it's one, maybe it's many, but ultimately it's for our benefit, which is crazy, but also for his benefit. And so I just want to take this time in communion that we would come up here in La Mesa, or if you're online, you know, you want to go to the fridge and grab some grape juice, that we would be reminded that this is an opportunity where God says to come to the table. God knows everything about you. In Galatians, it says that you don't even have to pray for your request. Even in your aches and groans, God knows what you need. I mean, to me, that's incredible, because I've been there where I can't even find the words, and have tried to, like, cry and, like, give those to God. And God has answered those things and given me what I needed, even if I didn't think that's what I needed at the time, but he still gave it to me. And that's amazing, because God knows me. And so this time of communion is a time to remember that God does know us. Maybe it's a terrifying thing that God knows you, because you have not given up certain things, but surprise, God already knows it. So this could be a time of repentance, of giving things to God that you think you have hidden from him. Adam and Eve tried to hide in the garden. They did not do a great job. You will not do a great job either. Also a time for you to know God in a more intimate way as well. He has given his body and his blood for you, for you personally. As a child of God, he died for your sins specifically. It wasn't, I will die for everyone except Brad, just a little too dirty. Your name literally was thought, he literally thought of you when he was dying on the cross, as your sins. And it was not too, it wasn't too much for Jesus. Jesus handled it, and he rose from the dead. So we're going to just go ahead and do a time of communion. And yeah, just really remember that God has chosen to know us, and he has given the opportunity for us to know him. And these are just some of the greatest things that God really could gift to us.
I've never done communion before. So it's going to be a first for me. Well, yeah, I have the communion, but I've never done it before. Y'all are more than welcome to come and pick up. You stand and come and pick one up. I know that in this day, we did this in remembrance of all he did for us. And as he... These things are childproof. I'm sorry. They're individual. You peel back to get the bread. I believe what it says. Bread.
Plastic off, and then there's that wafer. It looks like this white circle. And then you'll open that magenta top as well to get the juice. And so on the night before his death, Jesus took the bread and said, "This is my body broken for you and your sins." And then he took some juice and poured it out and said, "This is my blood poured out for your sins." And they took it together as his disciples. And so we also get to do that today as fellow believers and brothers and sisters. And so let us take the bread and the juice.
This is the blood broken and poured out for all of us. In this communion, sharing his love, this is the body. Oh, this is the blood. I will remember everything, Lord, you've done for me. I won't take for granted your sacrifice to set me free. My hunger is fierce for your love. Come fill me with it. This is a body. This is the blood broken and poured out for all of us. In this communion, sharing in love, this is the body. Oh, this is the blood. This is the body. Oh, this is the blood.
You know, we got one more song for you guys. I know that at the beginning of the service, we weren't able to grasp mostly none of it because of technical difficulties on my part. But, you know, for all you guys that are out there that didn't catch the beginning of it, I just want to recap and let you know that, you know, we did pray for everyone that had to concerns, joys as well. You know, to all you guys that we just want to let you guys know that we're here praying for you outside and in here in the church. And we're letting you guys know that God is with us through everything. Jim stood up here and he started telling us about all the difficulties that him and his wife have been going through these past couple of weeks. We also want to thank them for all they do. And we pray, we're still praying for all of us, for y'all. And just, you know, we got to be positive in everything that we do. And if we would, we just, you know, we got to give our hearts to the Lord. Amen. This is my desire, to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. If Lord, I give you my heart, give you my soul, and I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I wake, Lord, have your way in me. Let's sing that one more time. 'Cause this is my desire, to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All that I adore is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, and I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, and I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away, Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way in me.
As we just close tonight, let us just go to God and pray to him for all that he's done and all that he's going to. Lord, we just thank you so much just for this opportunity to come together as your body, whether that was in person or online. God, we just thank you that you're not a God who just sits up, who's all powerful and chooses not to know us, but that you're an intimate God who has come down from heaven in the form of a man, in the lowest of lows, to intimately know what it feels like to be human, but ultimately to know us personally. Lord, we just thank you that you would that you would lower yourself enough to just know who we are and what it feels like to be us. And we just ask that you would help us to know you even more. Lord, we just thankful that you are everywhere, that you are behind us and before us. You're beside us and all around us. You're within us. You're with us. You're with us in the morning and the evening, when we come and when we go. You are with us when we weep and when we rejoice. You are with us. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would remind us this week that that you are truly with us, and that we can go to you, and you personally, not a Moses, not a Jeremiah, but we can go directly to you, Lord, because who else better to go to than the person that knows us the most and the best? Lord, so we give you everything that we have because we trust you, because you have been faithful and that you know us, not just facts about us, but you know what makes us us, even more than we know ourselves. So, Lord, we just trust you with that, and we ask that you would be with us, and for those who weren't here today, that you would be with them as well. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.